stops now.
We've
Where
stopped
are
slightly
you?
over here.
But it's still not starting in 7 minutes. Where are your stops?
I'm probably going to travel with Emirates or Dubai. Yeah, Dubai, then from there, Montreal. So
Okay.
it's about 12 hours, then 12 hours, yeah.
Oh, I'm so sorry to hear that. That's a lot. No, we have around 11 hours.
Okay. Oh, that's better.
Yeah, that
Yeah.
sounds really horrible. I'm so sorry to hear that. That's
Yeah.
you have to take care of yourself to stay
To
healthy
stay
on the
healthy.
flight.
Yeah. Okay, we are
Yeah.
live.
Thank you. Okay, good. Okay. So warm welcome. So once again, there is an echo. Should I try again? Now it's still, maybe the online speaker should put out their, okay, now it's working. So thanks a lot. And we, you know, the technique, it's all still starting. So I think we hopefully we have solved everything. A warm welcome. My name is Martina Fleckenstein. I'm with WWF International, the head of global policy in our global food practice team. And the event today is one of a series on events on Koronivia, the joint future of Koronivia. And this is a major topic for WWF, but also for other organizations. I see Junge here, I see Gippard here. So it's really something where we all are very much also engaged in to really get a continuity and have a future on Koronivia. For those who maybe are not familiar with the Koronivia joint work on agriculture and maybe already struggling about the name, Koronivia was established in 2017 in the German Fiji Corp. And Koronivia is a research institute at the Fijis, and that's where this name coming from. Koronivia, the question is, why is Koronivia so important and why do we all want to see an ambitious future of Koronivia? The reason is that, first of all, Koronivia is the only sector which is mentioned under the convention. And that's something really to keep in mind. No other sector is mentioned in the convention. And the second one is the urgency on food system transformation. 30% of our greenhouse gas are coming from fruit production and consumption. And there is an urgency on transformation of our food system. And the Koronivia joint work on agriculture will or should be an important entry point. Currently, Koronivia is only considering soil nutrient use, livestock, and food security and in social economic dimension. But to tackle the food system, we need to consider not only the production, but we also need to consider the food loss and waste and diets. And the session today has a focus on food loss and waste. You will first get a short introduction from my colleague Clément Métivier now. He will talk about and give you an insight in Koronivia and the importance to strengthen Koronivia. And then we will have several presentations to give you insight why it is important to integrate food loss and waste in the future of Koronivia. I want to give the first hand over now to Clément to give us a little bit insight. He's with WWF. He's a senior expert on agriculture and on climate. And he was very much dealing over the last months in talking to negotiators, speaking. Clément, over to you.
Thank you very much, Martina. Um, Hi, everybody. This is really much a pleasure to be here. So in the next few minutes, I would like to really build on what Martina was saying.
Find me here.
And explain a little bit more about the Koronivia joint work on agriculture and also where food loss and waste goes in, and especially in the discussions about the next phase of Koronivia. So as Martina was saying, the Koronivia joint work on agriculture is quite an interesting object because it's the only work stream of the UNFCCC that focuses on a given sector, agriculture, which shows really how much agriculture is an interesting topic.
Until your next meeting.
All right, let's keep going. And another interesting fact about Koronivia is that it is really sitting under the two big subsidiary bodies of the UNFCCC. So SBI, the subsidiary body on implementation, and SAPSTA, the subsidiary body on scientific and technological advice. And so obviously, Koronivia has been happening for the past 5 years. And there has been quite a lot of activities happening around mostly six workshops on different topics. And obviously before each workshop, there have been a series of submissions shared by parties, but also observers. Then obviously the workshop themselves. And then after each workshop, a report to summarize the outcomes of everything that had been discussed there. And obviously in addition to those workshops, there have been also some efforts to connect Koronivia with the other parts of the UNFCCC that have something to do with agriculture, and especially in relation to topics like climate finance or adaptation, because there are a lot of linkages between agriculture and other work streams and other institutions in the UNFCCC. So obviously we are here at COP27, and there are two big tasks. And the first one is really about the finalization of the roadmap of Koronivia. So really about making a summary of everything that has been discussed for the past 5 years, and obviously making that sort of conclusion of the Koronivia roadmap. And what's also very important is the discussion about the next steps and the next phase of Koronivia.
Yeah.
And it's really critical because it's really about the future of agriculture and the future of food systems under the UNFCCC. And at the moment, it's very open. There are many, many options on what can be done in the future in terms of obviously the scope of the work, in terms of the objectives, the institutional arrangements, the different activities, the different topics that could be considered. So it's really a space to watch. And obviously going to food loss and waste, so far, it's not really been a key priority for Koronivia. But that being said, there have been some areas where food loss and waste has been considered under Koronivia in, for example, a few submissions. Also, if you look at the last meeting of Koronivia, which happened in Bonn in June at the intersessions, if you look at the draft text, it says that food loss and waste has a very high potential for climate change mitigation and adaptation. So there are really areas that we can build on and strengthen if we want to keep pushing food loss and waste as part of the next phase of Koronivia. And obviously, why does it matter to focus on food loss and waste? I mean, obviously, we know that food loss and waste represent around 8 to 10% of global greenhouse gas emissions. And also that around 40% of the food that we produce is actually wasted. And that if we were to reduce, oh, there's a bit of echo. Yeah, okay, great. So if we were to reduce food loss and waste, we could feed probably around 2 billion people, which is twice the number of undernourished people on the planet. So that's really a key issue that has to be considered in any discussion on Koronivia.
Francesco is the one leading the team here, no?
Exactly.
I heard the name a few months ago.
How are you?
At the beginning, when Francesco was still trying to meet Mohammed Nasser.
Yes.
I was in his office one of those days.
Sorry. All right.
Good work.
Thank you.
Good work.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
How is it?
All good.
All good.
It was well.
I don't know. We seem to be plugged in on something else, right?
Yes, indeed. You're almost welcome. It was 5 minutes.
We are probably eavesdropping on some negotiations or something.
Ah, il vient pas. Ah. Il vient plus, donc ça m'a facilité la tâche. Il n'y a pas de jet disponible. Non, c'est même pas qu'il n'y a pas de jet disponible. Il n'y a pas d'autorisation pour atterrir.
Il a enfin, c'est trop.
Non, c'est court pour qu'il ait l'autorisation. Donc les jets
peuvent faire du cardi. Les jets stylés. C'est. Trying to fix it now. Sorry for that.
Il n'a pas trop envie de...
Ouais, bon, c'est que pour la table ronde, peut-être ça vaut pas la peine, c'est ça. En tout cas, pour la finance, c'était bien. Hein.
Ah
Macron,
oui,
Mimotlé, ils sont assurés. Vera,
ils ont assuré.
Non, ils ont assuré, genre en termes de co-sharing, quoi, tu vois. Ils ont...
Ah non, mais ça, c'est...
Après, oui, en
termes de... Ça vient parler, ça vient, il parle bien. Macron, il parle bien. Mimotlé, c'est... Tu lui donnes le prix Nobel. Ah non, c'est... Vera, parfait.
Non, mais il y avait Georgie Eva, il y avait Thierry.
Yeah, I mean, I can't just like...
Carnet.
OK. Point concret? Next Monday morning?
I work in group.
OK, pour?
Pour genre formaliser les recommandations du Bridgetown Agenda.
Et I'm flexible.
Etc.
OK.
Et sur la réforme des
MDBs.
Et donc, un working group,
AMF,
Banque mondiale, CDE. C'est possible. non, mais il a dit il veut
I think it's mostly coming from...
Ah, all right.
Ouais. Il a promis de faire le truc. Quand ça visite d'État aux US, il va lobbyer le Congrès pour que... Ils limitent leur quota de milliards à de Wii Channel. Ils veulent passer.
Okay.
Ils veulent faire un nouvel issue.
Cette fois,
ils veulent donner 20%. Ils veulent donner 30%.
So, yeah, Martina.
Voilà, bon, c'est très bien qu'ils donnent. Parce qu'ils parlent de donner.
Il y a déjà 40 milliards dans la reste.
Ah oui, qu'ils donnent. Oui, ils ont donné. C'est 40 ?
Non, 40.
Ah, c'est pas 20 ? C'est 40 déjà ?
Tu as dit 40.
Tu as le il y a un listing des annonces qui ont été faites là.
On l'a préparé, on l'a envoyé à la présidente.
Parfait. Mais on voit le mois d'être. D'accord.
Il y a le CEO de Bank of Africa.
D'accord. J'avais demandé le CEO de Gates Philanthropy, de Gates Foundation.
Ouais, c'était
à cette table ronde là.
Non, c'était.
Il m'a dit qu'il a fait son annonce. Il a un pledge là. Il a fait son pledge. Tu peux me trouver ça?
Chose, ouais, à la table ronde.
C'est ça, c'est ça. Ouais. Ce serait bien de m'envoyer ça. Je voudrais bien voir.
Ouais. Et toi, ça va?
Ouais,
toi.
Ok.
Tu fais un peu les négos ou pas?
J'attends. J'ai un sujet sur le financement de l'adaptation. Le doubling, j'ai un agenda item dessus. Donc, j'attends de voir comment ça va se décompter. J'ai vu Wael rapidement hier soir.
Tu connais James?
Non?
Oh, yeah, James Cameron, yes. Yeah.
Oh, hello. How's everything? Uh-huh.
Good. How are you? Yeah, it's been a while. Very well. Thank you.
Working on seeing things on LinkedIn every now and again.
Yeah, I'm with the BCG. Huh?
Yeah.
Still on Planet, we're supporting the presidency.
Well, that's probably the best one.
Yeah, it's going well. Good. Very happy. Good. Good. How about you? I work with systemic. Are you still on systemic?
Yes, I have I'm a senior advisor.
Okay, I had something in Saudi Arabia earlier.
Yeah.
Is it on? Why?
There's so many things going on right now. It's like pollination, the other one I work with. It's getting bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah. Everyone is getting hired by politicians.
I know. It's like
you'll hire the whole top.
I
haven't heard about that one.
Oh, no, you should. I'll give you a card. Although this is actually just a bit out of date. Move addresses, but at least you can have a look at
pollination. Okay.
Yeah. I'll give you. That's me.
Your phone number?
Yeah.
That's the WhatsApp. I sent your WhatsApp.
Yeah, there's
delivering Nancy.
What's going on? Yeah, that's good.
It's an investment fund.
It's an advisory business and an investment fund. Started in Australia.
Okay.
But has offices now in the States and the UK and it's growing.
Okay.
Sydney is a former investment banker.
Yeah. Well, I mean.
Oh, look at.
And the chair of the Standing Committee on Finance. So, you might have a chat with him at some point.
We'll check that.
I will go on. Anyway, very nice.
Thanks, eh?
See you again.
Sorry about all this.
It's fine. Okay. So, let's just say,
you understand? KPMG?
No, in what the legal.
Legal?
Le plus grand cabinet, mais dans l'État, là, ça s'appelle. Bref. Et ils ont, ils ont débauché la moitié de leur équipe de Pollination. C'est une grosse boîte, ils ont plein de deals avec HSBC, avec. Ils ont des groupes de. Ils sont bien introduits, les gars. Voilà.
Okay.
Ils ont recruté plein de choses.
Ok.
Voilà. Et de quoi on parlait de Bill and Melinda Gates?
C'est ça. J'ai vu le CEO hier.
Oui.
Oui, non, c'est mon. C'est un documentaire qu'on fait. Donc.
Il te suit.
Mais elle est partie. Elle est partie voir Zaïre, justement.
Ils suivent les.
Non, c'est. Ils suivent le processus climat de différents angles. Et un angle, c'est les négociations avec AI, mais avec une négociation avec un biais mis en œuvre. Donc, ils me suivent depuis le début, presque depuis le début de l'année, sur AI. Comment est-ce que tu fais atterrir des choses concrètes sur le terrain? C'est-à-dire, on est allé, on était à Bonn, on était à Africité, donc la COP des collectivités. On est allé au village à Lomé. On doit visiter la mine d'hydrogène au Mali. En fait, ils veulent regarder de cet angle-là. Et puis, ils discutent aussi avec la société civile. Donc, ça fait un an qu'ils suivent la société civile africaine et ils ont découvert qu'il y a autre chose que la société civile, quoi, qu'il y a des négociations, qu'il y a
des
initiatives au-delà des négociations. Et donc, ils construisent. C'est un groupe, groupe de font des films documentaires qui passent d'ailleurs Netflix. Netflix, Amazon, tout le. Je ne sais pas s'ils vont, ils vont faire le documentaire après avec Netflix ou Amazon ou HBO.
One.
États-Unis. Ils sont américains.
That's great.
All right, great. Good. So yeah, Koronivia joint work on agriculture is very important. It's where agriculture is happening in the UNFCCC. And obviously the future is very important. And that's what we are discussing here in Sharm el Sheikh. And also food loss and waste, obviously a big topic. So what I'm gonna say is that in the discussions on the next phase of Koronivia, we need a large mandate. The entire food system, because so far the discussions have been mostly focusing on the sort of production side of things. And it's really important that parties agree on that strong and that clear mandate to cover all elements of food systems, including obviously food loss and food waste. And that approach is going to allow us to have a very strong, comprehensive grasp of the issue. So really, I'm looking forward to the discussions happening on Koronivia here in Sharm el Sheikh, and also looking forward actually to the interventions that are going to come next on food loss and food waste and what happens concretely on the ground to reduce food loss and food waste. Because I feel that governments really need to have that wider approach that really includes food loss and waste to make sure that we have a really comprehensive approach to the topic of food systems in the UNFCCC, and that the next phase of Koronivia can really deliver, obviously, for climate, for nature, and for people. Thank you.
Thank you, Clément. And I'm happy that we solved the technical problems. Because of this, we have a little bit to reorganize the agenda today, because some of the speakers have really to leave right in time. And I, Luguna, he just made it and he has to leave in 10 minutes. He lines for incinerary alternatives. And I from you, why is food loss and waste, and to integrate food loss and waste in Koronivia, so initiative, you're happy to hear listening to you about your program on the ground.
Thank you very much. Hi, everyone. Thanks to the technical challenges, I was here on time. Otherwise, I would have missed. The bus was going around, and then I spent like 45 minutes searching for this place. But thank you for the opportunity. I'm really glad to be here. I think most of the time we speak about, or in these meetings, we talk about food loss, food waste, and we lose the sight of critically imagining or visualizing the malnourishment that's happening in other parts of the world, and that could have been overcome by losses from the farms in Africa, where it's so difficult to transport your food from where it is being produced to where you can, your customers can have access or consumers can have access, or taking to the market. We have huge piles of food waste coming from markets, especially in Ghana, because the way it comes to the market and how it is stored is bound to have a lot of wastage. So it is very important, because when you look at accessibility, when you look at food security and nutritional availability for people, it is only feasible if we mainstream some of these conversations in the Koronivia. But also, most importantly, if we begin to connect the dots and draw the lines and make sure that whoever is somewhere understands where to have access to what they need and where to sell whatever they produce. For the Green Africa Youth Organization, the past 2 to 3 years, we have started what we call the Sustainable Communities Project, which we started in the central part of the country, and now scale to 4 municipalities. The model is that we want to manage waste in a zero waste approach, but the main focus is improving the food systems. improving the food system. Teaching market women who are selling substances to understand, that's first of all, what conditions are favorable for the food you are selling. So for example, I give you a clear example. If you mix, if you put one avocado, or if you put one orange in a bus full of avocado, that avocado completely go wasted, right? These are knowledge that some people do not know. Only the farmers and the rural communities understand these things. Not every food, somebody who buys and sells food. So we teach them this knowledge, first of all, to be able to avoid the wastage by their own means possible. And then the second thing is we take all the food wastage. So we work with a lot of women who are selling at the various markets. And then we take all the wastages and then we produce compost fertilizer. Currently, we supply 2,000 bags of compost, and these are huge bags of compost fertilizer. And almost everything is coming from food waste from the markets, 20% from food waste from homes. Now, the 20% is largely sometimes food waste that they could not use, and then in the posh area of Accra, where people do not feed the food waste to their animals. But the rest, they manage to feed the food waste to their animals, or they don't have it at all. But the markets generate just huge amounts of, I mean, if one organization in one municipality is producing 2,000 bags of compost fertilizer every month, and we are not even covering 50% of the capacity we need to, you can understand how much of that is being wasted. But in the same country, we have so many who are struggling to end a living, to put a 3 square meal in a day. Now, how do we bring stakeholders? How do we make sure that this is mainstreamed and then the dots are connected? That's what we are trying to do. For the past 1 year, we've been supporting the various municipalities. Thank God, some two municipalities are actually going to be in COP, speaking about the initiatives we have been doing with them. And together with the Ghana delegation, we are trying to send a message to the Africa Group of Negotiators that this is something that all of you have to be aware of. We know you have your key aspects that you are focused on, but this is also something that's very critical as far as life is concerned, as far as livelihood is concerned in the various countries. And I know this may not be only in Africa, but it is very, very visible in sub-Saharan Africa. And that's something that I'm happy to get more ideas, and I'm happy to forge partnerships that we can be able to together mobilize, build a momentum, and change the system. Thank you.
Thank you for letting us know about your initiative. And I think it's really great to listen what's happening on the ground. And I want to encourage you to continue and to extend what you're doing at the moment in your country. Thanks a lot. And to the next presentation. And if we talk about food loss and waste, we don't only, you have to leave, yeah. We didn't want to see this only in the Koronivia, but I think the other angle, and this is under the Paris Agreement, are the nationally determined, together with climate focus, we have assessed the nationally determined contributions and diets are considered at the moment in the NDCs. And I'm very happy to have Hasib with us. He's a senior consultant who worked on the report, and he will give us now some insights on the results in context with food loss and waste.
Thank you so much, Kilimo, Martina, and also this one. It was very inspiring to hear this one's initiative and what they are doing on the ground. And just taking a step back, it would be also good to look at some of the developments at the global level, and also what has been happening when it comes to transforming food systems for climate, for food security, for environment at the national level through the national determined contributions. But before I get into that, I wanted to give a quick anecdote or a story of what happened yesterday to me and Yana, my friend and former colleague. We went, it was around 2 o'clock, and we went to the grab and go place to get some food, and we ended up, and we were very hungry. And then we got up, we started chatting with people around us. So it was an interesting experience, but later I was thinking that it's moments like these when you realize how important food is, how all of us as living beings depend on food for our survival, and at the same time, how food cuts across cultures, cuts across languages, cuts across borders, and bring people together. The way we were talking with each other in that queue, and the way we talk in restaurants, kitchens, all over the place. When there is food, there's conversation, and there's a get together, and that's what brings people together. And at the same time, I also realized how food as a political agenda or as a priority, policy priority, cuts across sectors, cuts across industries. If it is the health sector, there is food. If it is food security, of course, there is food. If it is agriculture sector, there is food. If there is climate change and climate change mitigation action or climate change adaptation action, again, you have food in there. As Clément and Martina said, food system or the whole of how we produce food, how we transport them, how we distribute, process, and consume them or waste them, which forms the food system, how it is contributing to climate change by contributing 1/3 of the global greenhouse gas emissions. Of course, this contribution varies from region to region, from country to country, and from context to context, but food system and food crisis and climate crisis that we are facing today, I think in many ways are the two sides of the same coin. We cannot address one without addressing, we cannot address food crisis without really doing something about climate change. Because today, not only that food system contributes to greenhouse gas emissions, but at the same time, we see livestock dying in Somalia. We see floods destroying 1/3 of agricultural lands in Pakistan or in Nigeria, where millions of people are losing their livelihoods thanks to climate change. So if we have to, or if we want to address climate change, we need to also look at food systems and what we can do in the food system to address both food and climate change issues simultaneously. And next, it's with me, my bad. So then why food waste and food loss and NDCs? Well, NDCs as we know, or the mechanism that basically embodies the efforts of each and every member or parties to the Paris Agreement. And that's where parties outline their ambitions, their policy measures, and how they want to achieve those policy measures to address climate change mitigation and adaptation. And thanks to FAO and UNEP, organizations who have been quantifying the impacts of food loss and waste, we now know that more than 30, and some estimates put it at 40% of food is either lost after it's harvested, so either on the farm or in the transport or in storage, or it's wasted at the retail level when it's sold away, or we don't have refrigeration and the food goes bad, so we throw it away. Or at the restaurants where we just leave half of our plates and it's taken away and it's lost. But again, what Desmond mentioned, this varies across regions and countries. Food loss, that's post-harvest loss, happens a lot in developing countries because of lack of storage capacities, because of lack of transportation, or the distance between market and where the food is grown. While food waste happens in the industrialized and the rich, and there's just a lot of food, and we do not consume all what we buy or all what we can buy, basically, in the markets or restaurants. And 10% of total energy consumed globally is wasted thanks to the food waste that we cause, because 1/3 of the energy we use globally is actually used in the food systems, and 10% of global energy is lost because of food loss and food waste. And as Clément mentioned, roughly 8% to 10% of emissions is globally from food systems. So that's why food systems are important, and that's why food waste and loss is crucial within food systems and within our action on climate change. Come on. Yes. So as Martina mentioned, over the past several months, we looked at the nationally determined contributions, taking a food systems lens to understand how these documents include measures on sustainable food production, on addressing food waste and loss, and on shifting diets, and introducing practices like agroecology or regenerative agriculture at the production level. And what we did was to compare the most updated NDCs with the previous versions or submissions of those countries. And we looked at 134 updated NDCs representing 160 countries, which includes EU27, and compared those updated NDCs with the previous versions. One important thing that we looked at, how that has changed. And the finding is optimistic a bit, because almost all NDCs we looked at do have food in the measures, either adaptation measures or mitigation measures. They consider food and somehow, and there has been improvement in several countries where they didn't have food and mitigation measure or adaptation measures of disease, but now they have included in their updated NDC. So this map does show a rather positive development. And when we zoom in specifically on food waste and food loss, again, we see some improvement, but that's only part of the picture. We see that 36 updated NDCs consider post-harvest food measures generally, things like improving storage, things like improving transportation, shortening the supply chains, and refrigeration of food to make sure that food, when it leaves the farm or the growing area, it doesn't go bad before it reaches the market. And when you come to previous NDCs, there's an improvement because previous NDCs, only 21 of them had such measures. And when we look specifically, or when we look at how NDCs explicitly mention food loss and waste and measures for addressing food loss and waste, 19 NDCs have measures like we aim to reduce emissions from food loss or food waste, or reduce food loss and waste by this many percentages. And these explicit measures are also in many more NDCs than previously, as only 2 NDCs had such measures previously, but now 19 updated NDCs have these explicit measures, which is of course an improvement, but when you look at 134 NDCs, this is just a handful or just a small part of those. And there are some good examples of how countries are addressing food loss and waste in their NDCs. For example, we have mentioned 5, but there are a few more. Gambia, for example, sets a clear mitigation target of reducing emissions by almost 134 140 million tons of CO2 from food loss and waste. So that's a very ambitious target. Similarly, Sri Lanka, for example, pledges to reduce post-harvest losses and increase value chain of fruits and vegetables. And South Sudan is targeting access to market and transportation and cold storage solutions to reduce food losses. And China is introducing a policy called empty plate to make sure that everything is eaten on your plate and food waste is reduced. And Costa Rica is introducing food guides to not only reduce food waste, but also make a shift to more indigenous food products, agricultural products that are nutritious and also represent their cultural heritage. So these are some of good examples. But when you take a step back and look at how food system as a holistic approach is considered in indices, that's as in how different sides of or components of food system, food production, transportation, loss and waste and diets, how indices or governments are considering all of these together, there's still a lot of room for improvement. As we see, only 19 countries include both sustainable production measures as well as measures for reducing food loss and waste, but only 5 indices include sustainable production and sustainable consumption. And only 2 indices include all 3 stages of food chain, that is sustainable production of food, reducing food waste and loss, and shifting to sustainable and healthy diets. That's not great. We want all countries to reflect measures to address all components of food, including food waste and loss, to actually transform food system to address both climate change by reducing emissions, but also building resilient food systems, as well as increasing food security and creating livelihood for local communities. Some of the key recommendations, these are of course high level global recommendations that applies to most countries, but at the national level, regional level, and local level, there are hundreds of solutions that initiatives like this month's initiatives are pursuing to reduce food waste and food loss and ensure that people have access to affordable food at the same time. But some of them can apply to reduce food waste, food loss. Thank you so much. I won't go through them because there are a few lines. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Hasib. And for those who want to learn more about this study, I leave these small cards here. There is a barcode, and then you could just download. You will direct it. I put them here, and you could take it, and you will direct it to our webpage where you find the report. Due to time concern, I once again have to change the agenda, and I would like to ask Juan Pablo Hofmeister. He is the multilateral governance manager of the Office of Governance Affairs at the Green Climate Fund. And things are not happening without funding. And it would be interesting for us to know, to learn a little bit about how food loss and waste is or will be considered or is discussed in the Green Climate Fund. And thanks for staying a little bit longer.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, and it's an honor for me to join you today in this very important conversation. My name is Juan Pablo Hofmeister. I look after multilateral cooperation for the GCF, and we have been following the work of Koronivia with quite a lot of interest because we think that this is a tracking the multilateral process that have been for a long time underserved. We have been keen to see sort of beginning to grow a consensus around the important issues, the different issues on agriculture, as we have been seeing, but in the required thing that the findings demonstrated that there's beginning to be growing attention on these issues. I particularly telling to see, and this will get to the point that I would like to speak to with regards to financing, to see how it's beginning to be featured as part of the NDCs in ways that the first round were not. And so this is all to say, I don't think I need to convert the crowd on stressing the importance of these issues, but certainly the need to begin to build a sound basis as we try to make a case for the work for this work, which then takes me to my first point, and is the fact that we believe that this is an issue that all accredited entities need to start paying attention. And for this matter, this is an issue that we have started bringing in our sector guides to begin to provide emphasis on the fact that this is something that we don't want to be prescriptive about, but that they need to start looking at food loss in a manner that it's comprehensive, which takes me to my second point. And so far, what we have seen at the GCF is that in the context of food security, food loss has only been looked at in our funding proposals from the perspective of increasing resilience, which is great. It's a good place to start, but we are finding that when it comes to sort of accounting for the greenhouse gas reduction potential that is there, it's something that we're lacking quite a lot. And it is therefore that it will be quite timely for the work on Koronivia to begin to sort of build momentum around the methodologies that are required, to begin to have some momentum around having stronger and better accounting, because all of this will only help us bring sort of the multi-dimensioned of these issues in our funding proposals. So this is precisely the reason why we believe also that this area of work is fully aligned actually with the existing areas of Koronivia. So it's not like we are completely reinventing something new, and that therefore there's quite a lot of potential in what we can do here. Now, as I said, we have been doing some work over the last couple of years since this current replenishment period in providing some guidance to our accredited entities in how we're thinking around these issues. And so in the context of food security and agriculture, we have proposed three paradigm shift pathways that we believe are where we believe that these issues of addressing food losses and waste are quite cross-cutting and are quite key. The first one is, of course, around promoting resilient agriculture. And this is sort of one line where we are encouraging these to bring their funding proposals. And so this is a signal we're giving that we believe that there is potential for financing there. The second one is facilitating climate-informed advisory and risk management services. Obviously, this is quite connected to the resilience angle, but we don't believe that it's exclusive to it in terms of how we begin to sort of map how we capture some of these losses in food systems. And third and not least is, of course, perhaps the most challenging, but it's about how we reconfigure food systems. And I think this goes very much around the needs that have been presented in this presentation just before. So again, so far the GCF has not focused on food waste and greenhouse emission reductions. And therefore, we actually believe that many of our funding proposals at the moment might actually be underrepresenting what is there. And this is something that we want to address, which then takes me to my last point. And it is that, as some of you might know, the Green Climate Fund right now is undergoing its replenishment process, which means that we are in the process of laying forward the strategic directions in which the GCF is going to be channeling resources for the financing period starting in 2024-2027. So it's a cycle. And we are trying to put food loss and waste as a priority issue and GCF2. Of course, all of this is under discussion and negotiation by our board, but we believe that it's a clear emerging priority. And frankly, when we look at the numbers that just presented, it is frankly also quite a low-hanging fruit to try to go after these emissions. We think that particularly in the context of the transition pathways that I mentioned before that are captured in our sector guides, that there is a potential for a key focus on circular economy, upcycling, recycling, that could bring some of these benefits. Of course, in order to achieve this, we believe that there is still a key focus on the measurement of greenhouse reductions that needs to be done. There is a lot of capacity that needs to be built in order to get our partners ready to be able to account for these benefits. But it's something that needs to be done. And in that sense, with this support, we hope to provide in the next replenishment cycle, hand in hand, will need to come for empowering our accredited entities to build the capacity for the methodologies that are required to be able to do this accounting properly. I think I will end there, mindful of, thank you very much. And unfortunately, I won't be able to stay around for too long, but our pavilion is just down the hall, and feel free to come by for any questions and we can take it from there. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Juan Pablo. That was very encouraging also listening that the GCF is thinking about having food loss and waste as a, you mentioned, low-hanging fruit, maybe in the next round of the GCF. And we would be really happy also to follow up with you. It's a priority for WWF. We have a huge program on food loss and waste. And I also, for those who are here in week two, we have a reception and a pledge event on the 16th in the evening in our WWF pavilion. Once again, and I have already talked to my colleagues on the screen, they have a little bit more time. And I know that I think Veronica also is a little bit under time pressure. So I'm happy to ask Veronica to the stage. She's the head of climate change unit at the Ministry of Agriculture in Kenya. And she is an expert on agriculture and climate change, also dealing with Koronivia in the last years. And I'm very happy to have you here. And we want to listen in what you think are the interests of the parties to consider maybe the integration of food loss and waste in the future of Koronivia. Kenya was one of the countries who mentioned food loss and waste as one of the topics for the future of Koronivia.
Thank you so much. And I don't know whether it's still morning or it's afternoon. Introduce. So I'll start straight by, first of all, responding to why Kenya in our submission to the future of Koronivia felt that food post-harvest management of food needed to be included on the issues of discussions under the Koronivia or under agriculture in the UNFCCC. And this is because in Kenya, we have quite substantial losses, and that contributes to food insecurity. Because when we look at our grains, about 20% of the grains we produce are lost through post-harvest management, that is after harvest or during harvest. Again, fresh produce, which includes vegetables and fruits, a substantial amount of it is lost. And this all amounts, I think that goes to something like 40 to 50% losses. And this causes a lot of, it reduces the amount of food that people would be available for food, for people to consume. The other reason that we felt that post-harvest and losses need to be included in our discussions and you had the climate continues to change. It also impacts on temperatures increase, and also the the rainfall becomes more unpredictable. The seasons are becoming a bit and reliable. The experiences we have in Kenya is that sometimes it's supposed to be hard. It's like concentrating on prawn is not going to be enough. We need to look at how do we handle the food when the rains comes, when the food is still at the farm, and the farmers have put all the efforts in place, and they are not to produce, but now they are losing it at the farm. There are also the issues of the infrastructure. It has to be transported to the markets and to the storage facilities. There's climate change impacts are also impacting on that, because you get a lot of rains, you get climate risks like the floods, and then the infrastructure is destroyed. And that means then a lot of the food is wasted. And particularly that happens to the perishable agricultural produce, so that farmers are or traders are with their lorries somewhere, the bridge has broken down, the road is impassable, they're not able to reach the market, and that gets wasted. That also needs to be addressed. At the market also, we have issues of whatever is not sold, where does it go? And so in most of our fresh markets, you find there are a lot of waste because whatever farmers and traders bring to sell does not, whatever doesn't get sold and it is highly perishable, it gets wasted. So that means that we could put a lot more effort in production, and if we don't concentrate on the at that level of post-harvest management, we are not addressing the food systems, or we are not addressing agriculture in the Koronivia joint work on agriculture. And that was actually the basis for Kenya to propose that we need issues of post-harvest management, management of food losses to be addressed under UNFCCC. Then the other thing is that we also get at the production level, what you do at production also affects the post-harvest. Currently we get diseases like what we get and pests, like in Kenya, we have had in recent years, things like the maize lethal necrosis disease that affects the crop in the field. And this crop, when it's harvested, it's already of low quality. And once it is taken to the store, when it's of that low quality, then it also is going to get spoiled very fast. The increased temperatures that are affecting, we know that temperatures are increasing as a result of climate change. Our stores do not have that control of how do they control the storage system when the temperatures increase. So again, because of the high temperatures, we get crops or foodstuffs getting rotten, rotting in the stores, and also getting affected by post-harvest. And so for us, we feel that it's important, as we struggle to address the issues of production within the Koronivia joint work on agriculture process, that we are concluding, also becoming very difficult to conclude, but we feel that it is important that these issues are all addressed together, so that we only don't address one side of the value chain and we omit the other. Then later now we begin to say that, oh, this one has not been addressed. And so as we look at sourcing for resources or talking to those that provide to us the technologies, the capacities, and the finances to address agriculture within the climate change space, then these issues of the food that has already been produced, looking at how we store it, how we distribute it. We also have this challenge of not even in across countries, but even within our country, you have we have crops being, or even livestock products like milk being produced in one part of the country, but not able to get the other, particularly the hassle parts of the country. And this happens a lot because, like, even today, as some people in Kenya are really devastated because of the drought that has been there in the most of the hassle areas of Kenya, you also have some other part of Kenya whereby there is overproduction of things like cabbage and other perishable produce. And then it is not able to get, I mean, people on one part of the country are dying of hunger or they are very devastated because of hunger. Yet in another part of the country, they are crying that there is no market for the produce. So distribution of these foodstuffs is very important. Transportation, addressing the infrastructure, addressing the marketing systems so that they are able to serve both the producer and the consumer is very key. So then we feel that it's very key that food losses and waste need to be addressed within the discussions in agriculture under the Koronivia Joint Work on Agriculture or whatever system is going to come after this. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Veronica, and thank you also emphasizing the importance to also invest finance on food loss and waste, on infrastructure, and thanks also for your support and your supporting us on bringing food loss and waste in the Koronivia discussion. For our next speaker, we stay in Kenya. I am very happy to have my colleague Olivia Adhiambo. She is a climate resilience specialist and she's still in and waiting. Thanks for your patience, Olivia. And she has over 14 years of experience in Kenya. And before I give the micro to Olivia, my colleagues have done in WWF Kenya. So I hope there were those you still could stay another 10, 15 minutes. Sorry for being a little bit late now. On the technical people, could you show the video fishery and aquaculture fishery project? Okay, it should work. We need to have a totem, maybe.
The first one. Single one, but I don't forget my power.
Yeah, that's the right one. Should we ask Olivia to show it from her computer? Oh, it works. Olivia, if you want to speak alongside with the video, I don't know if this is possible. You could also talk.
Kikundi hichi ni kikundi cha mama ambao wanahusika katika kazi ya kuuza samaki.
Sisi huwa tuachukua samaki kupitia kwa madilas. Wavuvi wanaenda kuvua samaki kule. Wakija hapa kuna wasimamizi wao ambao ni madila, wanatuuzia kama sisi. samaki wadogo anapewa mama karanga. Wale wakubwa kama sisi tunahitaji samaki wakubwa. Sisi tuna kwa samaki wakubwa tunaenda kuuza mbele mbele huko ya masoko. Kitambo ilikuwa ni mbinu ya kuhangaika hapa na pale ama uende kwa jamaa mwingine ukachukua mapande ya barafu ili tujitifadhi samaki yetu ama tuatoka naye hapa kwenda naye Mombasa mara samaki ameharibika. Sasa ilikuwa hakuna usalama wa ajali au utulivu wa biashara. Ilipofika 2018 tukaungana na WWF tukawapa mawazo yetu jinsi tunahitaji kina mama wawezeshwe.
We had realized that post harvest losses is quite an issue with the fisher folks that we are targeting in most of these projects. So as WWF Kenya and WWF Denmark and WWF UK, we designed a project that will tackle the issue on fish post-harvest losses.
Katika mradi tulikuwa mafriza manne ya sola ambayo yako pale ndani ambayo yanatufaidisha sisi kwa wakati tulionao sasa. Mafriza haya yanatumika kuhifadhi samaki ambao ni jamii hapa washikadau ambao tulionao hapa bandari hii ili kila mtu awe huru kuweka samaki pale lakini kwa sheria zake.
The technical advantage of the Kigali project that we are implementing here at the coast is that it's green. Basically, it's environmentally friendly. It's environmentally friendly in the sense that the technology itself, it uses solar. And the refrigerant in the freezers, it's compliant to the Kigali amendment. So it's basically non-HFC. At the same time, it's low cost because solar is quite an affordable source of power. And at the same time, these technologies, it's user friendly.
Kutusaidia za tusaidia vya kutosha. Kwa sababu pale tuna makula ambayo yako pale ndani. Mtaweza kunwa madonge yake, akavunja-vunja, akasafirisha samaki wake. Ama mvuvi akachukua makula, akaenda na baharini kule, samaki mwenyewe.
For both sites, there is a working maintenance plan that the community use to operate this equipment. Some members of the BMUs were trained on how to operate this equipment. At the same time, we went ahead to train the fish at the fisher level, the traders on issues on sustainable fisheries, fish post-harvest losses, fish handling, and also issues on financial management.
Biashara imenifanya mimi kidogo nikajenga kibanda changu cha nyumba na nazalisha watoto wangu pia kupitia hii biashara. Watoto pia saizi wako mashuleni wengine kwa college. Nashukuru hili shirika la WWF Kenya ambao ni Kigali ambao imetusaidia sana hapa bandari hii ambao sahihi kidogo hata vijana pia sahihi.
But we are saying that this is not the end. We have other projects that are coming in that are going to be supporting the fisherfolk communities along the coast on these aspects. Aspects on sustainable fisheries, aspects on fish post-harvest handling, aspects on governance structures. These are something that are continuous for us. And the partnership that we have fostered with the government and also the national government will play a very key role in us attaining all our sustainable fisheries goals.
Yeah. Olivia, we are a little bit running out of time. We highlight the most important success factors in 1 or 2 minutes. That would be great.
Thank you. Thank you, Martina. So you've heard for yourself, the project was designed to handle post-harvest loss. So one of the challenges was that fishermen along fish. Can you hear me?
Yes, we could hear you. If you speak up, as speak up a little bit would be good. Okay, is this better? Hello, can you hear me now?
Yeah, it's fine.
Great, thank you, Martina. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll just highlight the challenges that the fishermen were facing. The first one was overfishing. Overfishing was primarily fueled by post-harvest losses. So fishermen did not have facilities to handle the fish, process the fish, and store the fish. This requires refrigeration facilities. So this post-harvest loss meant
Olivia,
that...
Olivia, sorry, we have really internet connection.
Yes, I can hear you.
Olivia, the connection is not stable here. So we had this wonderful video which gave us a very good...
There's an echo. So I can hear a lot of echo.
Okay, I try again. So we are still... Once again, good. I try. So Olivia and I also do. We had the video of Olivia, which gave us a great insight what's happening in Kenya. And for Christina, I feel a little bit bad, but it doesn't work from technique wise. So I want close this session and give now the micro to my last speaker, to Alex from Congo, and please introduce yourself.
And I'm Representative Yango. I'm a member of the Yango Agriculture Working Group, and I'm also a COP delegate of Swiss Youth for Climate, which is the NGO I represent here. I'm also a student in Master in Sustainable Development at the University of Basel, and my main focus area is food and agriculture. And coming back to your point, I see like about the food was really important here. We are actually working with the Yango Working Group about giving a proposal to the UNFCCC to have a better food offers at COP, which should be more sustainable, more affordable, and more local as well. So we're working on it, and we try to plan an action about food waste also here at COP27. So that's kind of the introduction from my side. And now coming to my point, like why do we need to integrate food waste to the Koragina joint work program? It's basically because, as we know, we need to consider the topic of food waste from a holistic perspective, I think. That's one of the main challenges, in the sense that food waste, as we learned today, is really like separated in where the consumer process, the production and the supply, and we need strong on all of this level if we want to integrate this in the Koragina. We are all aware, I think, of the amount and kind of still thinking of it, especially at so. Way more So including food waste and losses in the Koronivia is a massive opportunity to reduce our carbon footprints and at the same time to fight hunger. Today, eight, and at the same time, we are wasting more than 1 billion kilos of food every year. So there's definitely a paradox here. The Western tree that are prepared to take our responsibility about it and to do something. I think I can give you like 3 of my ideas that could be implemented. One is about the consumer side, one is about the supply chain, and one is about the industry. First of all, the consumer government, especially in the Western countries and developed countries, should develop established food loss awareness campaign so that the citizen can have some ideas about what is the impact, how complex it is, and to give them some best practices. Then we should also try to define a clear allocation part of funding at COP27 to the food loss and waste issue, because that would help us to supply and to improve the infrastructure. The food waste is this issue and to fight this problem. Then we can also try to develop strong guidelines for the wholesale industries and to make them aware of their impact. So we could, for example, develop a compliance rule so that every food retailer should assess, report, and monitor their food waste along their supply chain, and they should provide this report to the federal office, national office of nutrition, so that they can track it and collaborate with the government, with the science, to have a reduced food waste amount. Then we can also try to erase calibration, because I didn't mention it, but I'm the co-founder of a local association which provide organic and local fruit and vegetable to students and companies in Switzerland. And one of the main funding that I was able to see during the process of this association is that the wholesale things about calibrate lost just because of their size or just because they're ugly. But in the end, you know that each product has the same. So we should really kind of like, I don't know, like stop us to find a way to fight food waste. And maybe the last point, it's about trying to have a new legal framework to implement the true cost of food. It's a bit beyond the scope of food waste, but it's still really important, because if we make the real true cost of food available to the it's about the energy consumption of the product, the water consumptions, the pesticides consumptions, then people will be way more aware of the real cost of the product, and they might be more keen to reflect a bit more about their consumer habits. And then as a closer, I think to raise this issue and make it as a key element within the Corona work program, we need to recognize it within informal meetings, into workshop, and then prioritize it into modalities and policies. That's the goal of this COP, to have implementations. No more talk, but implementation. That's what we need. And the fight against food waste is definitely one of the most underestimated levers of action at COP, and its potential is massive. So we need to tackle this. We know, nevertheless, that it's a transversal dimension, and it's necessary to develop measures that, as I said, include all of the actors. So it's quite complex, but the benefits are really high. So I urge the parties as a conclusion to do so, and I hope we will find a way to fight this issue together. Thank you.
Thank you, Alexis, and also for your very clear words. And I'm very, things very encouraging to see youth involved. And having us with here with us. And thanks for all your support. Thanks for everybody staying a little bit longer. We are at the beginning and technical problems. I think they're all in all the pavilions, what I heard. Thanks a lot. Have a nice day. And for those who are interested, tomorrow at 1 p.m. event on Koronivia, which is guided by Clément. It will show concrete case studies how Koronivia could be implemented in the future. Thank you.
No, I need to go now.